Ham Radio Now, episode 62. Oh, no, wait, I didn't want to reveal that quite yet. Pay no attention to the title that's covering up my chin. It seems like there's a great hunger across the ham radio world for programs on software-defined radio. I just finished up releasing episode 61, which is my talk with Greg Jurrens K5GJ from Flex Radio. And we got into the basics of software-defined radio. In fact, if you're watching this program, you probably watched that program. And in that program, I had talked about a talk that I had seen some years ago and recorded for ARVN by Phil Harman, VK6APH, who I kept saying VK4APH. And it's something I made a DVD of. Now I can reveal it, I guess. It is software-defined radio through the looking glass. So I'm going to rip myself off in this episode and basically just show you what's on that DVD. The big deal with the Flex 6000 series is that for the first time in ham radio, we're going to come out of the antenna connector and through not much more than a filter, and then into the A to D converter, and do everything else, the filtering, the demodulation, all of the peripherals, all the stuff that you normally expect a radio to do, do it all digitally, and then just come back to the analog world for sending stuff to the speaker or the headphones or to your screen display if it's a digital mode. And that's pretty groundbreaking, but this receiver did it first, at least for amateur radio. The Mercury receiver from the HP SDR group, that's a high-performance software-defined radio. It's kind of a loose-knit group, somewhat associated with TAPR, that enjoy doing advanced projects. And one of their big ones is this software-defined radio system that the Mercury receiver is part of. And this receiver, it also came out of the antenna connector through a filter and then off into the A to D converter and became a bit stream that was manipulated. The Flex radio is advanced compared to that, but this is where it sort of got started. I want to show you a couple things from the DVD. This is the menu that you would see if you were looking at the DVD. And when I made the DVDs, I made some pretty extensive chapter indicators. And again, this is going to be in three parts. The DVD was in three parts. The reason for doing three parts is that each of these is close to an hour long. And an hour is about as long as I want a Ham Radio Now program to go, because in order to fit it in the 1.5 gigabytes I can send up to Blip, the compression that is required to go much beyond an hour gets pretty extreme, and the programs don't look as good. So I try to keep things around an hour tops. I'll push it a little bit more if I need to, but we'll split it up into three pieces. So back to what the DVD looks like. I did some pretty extensive chapter notations, and this is what they look like. I'll give you a moment to absorb some of that. These are the things that Phil is going to be talking about. I can't do the chapter notations online here. Well, actually, I could. The YouTube version of the program would allow me to come up with links that would take you to specific parts of the program. But it would be a lot of work, and I'm just not going to do it. It was a lot of work when I did the DVD. If somebody out there wants to do that with this or any other Ham Radio Now program, and pick specific things out and make sort of chapter indications with links to the YouTube version of the program, feel free, send them to me and I'll put them on the website. Anyway, one more thing about the DVD, if you were to buy it, you still can. I've got a dozen or two left, and I'll make more if I need to. If you want to buy it with the chapter indicators, and I think the video quality will be a little bit better on the DVD. Although it is standard definition, it's back in the days before I had high definition equipment. The DVD would be $15, and you get to watch it for free here on the web. But if you think that the program is worth something to you, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, visit ARVN, the mascot, click on his icon, and you can make a contribution, whatever you think the program is worth to you. All right, I think I've got all the business out of the way. I will not be back for the beginning and end of the next two parts of this this episode. I'll just kind of fade them in and fade them out. So this is all you're going to hear from me. Oh, yeah, one more thing. I thought this was all that was you were going to hear from me. One more thing. I'm going to rip myself off again in episode 63. In 2009, there was a Software Defined Radio Forum at the Dayton Hamvention. There was also a TAPR Forum, and this DVD has both. I'm only going to rip off the Software Defined Radio Forum. So just be watching for that. It's going to come up pretty soon. And I'll tell you all about that in the episode, I think episode 63, for the Dayton 2009 Software Defined Radio Forum. Somebody told me, can't put up enough programs about software-defined radio. We'll see if we can wear you out. Let's go up to Chicago and back in time, Sherman, crank up the Wayback Machine, 2008, and Phil Harman, VK6APH, and the development of the Mercury software-defined receiver.
All right, without further ado, we want to bring up our very distinguished speaker, Phil Harman, coming in from the west coast of Australia, from what I understand is the best kept secret. They don't want too many people to know about how wonderful they have it over there. He's flown in to give us this lecture. We've asked him to come down. We're very privileged to have Phil. Phil, of course, has been very instrumental in the HPSDR project. He also wrote a series of articles for RSGB about software-defined radio. So we're very pleased to have Phil. Phil, come on up and we'll let you get started. And of course, we're going to go for a full 4 hours. Phil's planning some breaks in between. And also, I've got the microphone here, so it is being recorded on the DVD. If you have questions, let's take a moment to capture them on the microphone, okay? So without further ado, Phil, it's all yours.
Well, good morning. Well, perhaps in my current jet lag state, I should say good evening. I'd like to thank ALL and TAPR for the opportunity to come and present to you today. It's a great privilege for me to come to Chicago. And a couple of other people I really wanted to thank and acknowledge before I start. Firstly, Phil Covington, N8 Victor Bravo. I've worked with Phil on many other projects in HPSDR from the early days of the Janus board, from the Aussie board, which Phil was project leader on, and the Atlas bus. And we started working on the Mercury project together, which is going to be a large component of my talk today, the architecture of Mercury. And Phil's very kindly put all his code for Mercury and now his commercial version of Mercury, the QSR1, into the public domain. So we've still got access to Phil's great engineering and software skills, which is tremendous. I'd also like to extend my great thanks to Bill, KD5TFD. Bill has tolerated my weekend projects now for about three years. I've only just met Bill for the first time this trip. We speak virtually every day on TeamSpeak. Lunchtime in Perth is programmer's evening in Texas. So Bill and I have formed a great relationship, and it's a great privilege to work with you, Bill, and I appreciate you as a friend. Thank you very much. Bill's made a tremendous contribution to HPSDR. He's an unsung hero of the software side of the product, and I'm sure he'll continue to make a great influence on the project. Since we're going to be spending a bit of time together, I thought I'd give you a little bit of my background. I've been a ham for nearly 41 years, which I worked out last night could be a bit of a problem, because from the age I tell people I am, that means I must have got licensed at 5 years old. That's wrong, I was actually six, but never mind. I was first licensed in the UK as G3WXO, as a schoolboy. And my first early career was working in RF analog design. I worked for the government. I was fortunate enough to work on embassy communications between London and the various embassies around the world. And in those days, they were moving over from teleprinter to a sort of a digital communications mode, which we know now as Piccolo. it wasn't really a digital mode. It is digital today. You can run Piccolo code on a sound card. And Piccolo used 32 tones, one tone for each character with a shift key. And if you listen to hear Piccolo on the radio, it sounds like someone playing a Piccolo, and that's where the name came from. So as a very, very young engineer, I was privileged to hand-wind the toroids that that Piccolo used. There was 32 toroids. They were tuned 10 hertz apart, starting from about 300 hertz. And there were thousands and thousands of turns on here. So I got pretty good at winding toroids. So. Okay, Scotty? Okay. About 30 years ago, I decided I could do with some finer weather. So we decided to move to west coast of Australia. And apart from working in the US on and off for about 10 years, I've spent most of my time in Western Australia. My current work, what I do today, is my passion is to work with new ideas, new technology, and people who do interesting, exciting things. And I'm fortunate enough to work with many different companies, varying, not necessarily in technology. Some of them, one of the companies I work with does occupational health and safety testing. It's a technique for checking whether, when people sign on to come to work, they should actually be at work. They're not physically or mentally impaired, so not electronics product at all. At the other end of the scale, I work with a company who's producing testing equipment for a new type of car brake, which is very exciting. I try and get involved in electronics projects as much as I can, but I really, you know, I'll take anything that I think is really exciting and interesting. I get to spend a lot of my time making presentations, asking people for money to help support my projects. This is very easy. You guys have already paid, so I haven't got to try quite so hard as I normally do. I don't work as a design engineer. I don't work doing software. I've no formal background in writing software, as anyone who's read my code will fully appreciate. In fact, up until a few years ago, I couldn't spell FGPA, and I still can't, as you can probably tell. My presentation is pitched at the enthusiastic amateur, not the professional. If you do this sort of work all day, there's probably very little that you're going to find new. If there's something that's fairly new to you, you're interested, you want to learn more, understand how this technology works, then hopefully I'm going to pitch that at your sort of level. A minimum of math, just a little math just to show you how simple this stuff really is. But it's really how the thing works, how the hardware works, and I'm going to focus very heavily on a new technique where we digitize the signal directly at the antenna socket, process it, and then pass it over a communications link to a PC. Probably, I know there's many programmers in the audience, you've worked on the software end, perhaps in the PC, but perhaps the little black art between antenna and generate that INQ to go over the communications link with the PC may be a little bit new, so that's where I'm going to work. The slides I have contain a lot of practical information. Virtually every slide is something I've actually tried or actually used or actually worked on, so the stuff actually works, whether I'm explaining it correctly or it's 100% mathematically sound, I don't know, but it does work, so that's my story. I just like it a bit of fitting for demographics, just make sure I'm picking my audience correctly. My earliest exposure to this sort of technology was in phasing rigs, building phasing rigs for sideband transmitters receivers. Anybody here worked on phasing transmitters, phasing receivers? Yeah, okay. Anyone used the soft rock? That's great. Lots of soft rocks. SDR 1000, Flex 5000? Yep. Okay, and HP SDR boards, Atlas, Aussie, Janus. Oh, well, we're good friends here. I'm going to try and talk for about an hour each session, have a little bit of a comfort break, have a drink, and then we'll push on. Very happy to take and encourage questions during the procedure. If I cover it later on, I'll say just hang on, we'll pick that up on a future slide. If I can't answer the question, perhaps someone else is quite happy to pop up and answer it. I'm really too happy to do that. Now, Scotty said to me, what's my preferred method of taking questions? And ideally, what I'd like you to do is write the question on a dollar bill and just... Okay. Yeah, that'll be fine. Yeah, it's nearly par now, so that's fine. For short questions, a dollar's fine. If you have big questions and use a larger denomination bill, that'll be fine. So, what we're going to cover today is an in-detail look at digital down conversion. This is the technology where we take an antenna, plug it directly onto an analog digital converter, and eventually get that signal into the PC. Very short question. Okay, so this is the agenda today. We're going to look at, just to bring you in gently, we can look at the background of software-defined radios, the sort of architectures we use. And this background applies to whether we're doing analog processing using a conventional sort of analog mixer, or we're doing the latest analog-digital conversion techniques. We'll look at some of the current SDR hardware architecture. We'll look at the advantages and disadvantages. Neither of the techniques that are currently popular are perfect, and we'll look at why. We'll then look at direct digital down conversion, which is what the majority of the talk will be about then. We'll look at the direct digital down conversion design example of the Mercury board. Hopefully many of you got to see Mercury running live in the room next door the last few days. We'll look at some of the problems with analog to digital conversion, what the issues are. It looks good in theory, but in practice there's a few gotchas, which we found out the hard way. We'll look at how we go from the analog to digital converter to the PC, the type of communications medium we can use to get between the two. We'll look at numerically controlled oscillators. These are the equivalent to a software VFO, and what the options and trade-offs we have there. We'll look at decimation. My wife's actually involved in decimation at the moment. She's gone shopping, and she's going to decimate my wallet, I'm concerned. We'll look at some digital filtering, how they work. A simple high-level view, and a couple of filters that we actually use inside Mercury and why we use them and how they're designed. We'll look at some actual performance figures from Mercury, see how well the radio actually works, and then I'll also discuss some of the future projects that are going to be rolling out, hopefully through HPSDR and TAPR in the near future. So, a quick overview. Software-defined radios are now providing performance equal to the best analog device. If you look at Rob Sherwood's page, I think you'll see at the moment the K3 is in the way that Rob does his testing, is rated number one, and the Flex 5000, which is a software-defined radio, is a close follow-on at number two. So we're now getting performance of the best analog radios. This technology is starting to become mainstream, and particularly if you're a contester in the performance of the band scope that you have with a software-defined radio, if you're not using a software-defined radio as part of your contest station, you're probably going to start sliding down the ladder. So this is now a serious mainstream technology. Now, there's a new trend in HFSDR radios that eliminates most of the analog components, and that's what we're going to be concentrating on today, getting rid of the analog components and digitizing as closely to the antenna socket as we can. And we'll see why we want to do that, what the advantages and what some of the disadvantages of doing that are. So, in effect, the antenna is connected directly to the input pin of an analog to digital converter. We want to get rid of as much of the analog components as possible, and I'll explain in detail why we might want to do that in a few slides. So, how does it work? And more importantly, how well does it work? This is the basic architecture of current software. The majority of radios today, software-defined radios, use this architecture. They're based on the use of sound cards or a sound card chip. So, we have some form of input bandpass filter, which feeds its signal into two mixers. The mixers are fed from a common local oscillator. One input is fed directly from the local oscillator, and one is fed through a 90-degree phase shift. So the same frequency goes to both mixers, but there's a 90-degree phase difference between this local oscillator and this one. We then have some form of amplifier, low-noise amplifier, and a low-pass filter. And we then generate two signals, our I signal and our Q signal, in phase and quadrature. The bandwidth of the I and Q signals is limited by the sampling rate of our sound card, which is typically 48, 96, or 192 kilohertz. The higher the sampling frequency, the wider your band scope is. And if you have 48 kilohertz sampling, you have a 48K wide band scope, 96 kilohertz, 192 kilohertz wide. They're directly proportional. For you guys with soft rocks, this will be a familiar picture. Here's a 40 meter soft rock. So all the components on this board are really doing analog processing. The antenna comes in, it is mixed down to a baseband signal of between naught and your sampling rate, 48, 96, 192 kilohertz. And from the previous slide, we get two signals coming out, our Q signal and our I signal. To get into the digital world, we need to do analog to digital conversion, and we use the input of our sound card, our stereo sound card, so say left channel takes Q, right channel takes I. We then have a mixer, so we can do some fine tuning on the incoming signal. I'll cover that in more detail later on. And then we use our PC, we're now in the digital world, to do our digital signal processing. Once we've done our filtering, our AGC, our noise limiting, etc., we convert back from a digital signal to our analog signal by going back through our sound card, and we end up with a signal we can hear on the speakers or on headphones. Standard technology, I think there's well over 6,000 soft rocks that Tony's sold now, so it's becoming a very popular architecture. And lots of advantages, a few disadvantages, which we'll look at now. So, in terms of performance, one of the great features I think of software-defined radios is the band scope. Being able to look in real time across the band and see what signals are active is a very valuable feature, I think. The width of the band scope, how much signal you can see, how much chunk of a band you can see at a time, is limited, as I mentioned before, by the sampling rate. The best sound cards I'm aware of will sample at a maximum of 192 kilohertz, so that's the maximum bandwidth of your band scope can display. This is basically direct conversion receiver technology, which many of you would have played with in its analog form over the years. There is, because it's basically a superhet technology, there's the problem of an image, and the image appears at twice the IF away. So if we tune our receiver to 14.1 kilohertz, and we have a 10 kilohertz IF, that's the 10 kilohertz IF is the signal going into our sound card to go from analog to digital conversion, then we'll have an image at 14.08 kilohertz, twice the IF away. And that occurs, whatever frequency you tune to, we'll always have that image twice the IF away. Now, we can get rid of that image, and we do that by carefully balancing the I and Q signals. Generally, in the technologies we have today, the limitation to how much image suppression we can attain is limited by the analog components in the system. So it's the mixers, it's the amplifier after the mixers, it's the low-pass filters. All those analog components contribute to an error between exactly the same amplitude for the I and Q signals and an exact 90-degree phase difference. Any deviation from exactly the same amplitude and 90 degrees phase means we can't get perfect image cancellation. And here's some figures. If we want to get rid of our image by 40 dBs, then our 90-degree phase between the I and Q must be within 1 degree. And the amplitude must be within 0.1 of a dB. If we go up every 20 dBs, we go up by an order. So at 60 dBs, the phase must be within 90 degrees, within 0.1 of a degree, and the amplitude 0.01 a dB. Now, a modern analog radio will give you well over 100 dB of image reduction, so that's what we should be aiming at, in which case we're looking at 90 degrees within 0.001 of a degree and 0.0001 of a dB in amplitude. That's a pretty tall order. And that is one of the reasons why phasing transmitters and phasing receivers fell out of vogue the moment crystal filters turned up. Because not only have we got to keep these accuracies both in phase and amplitude over the audio bandwidth, which is what we're listening to or if we're transmitting as a transmitter, we've also got to keep it constant with temperature, component aging, vibration, voltage fluctuations. So it's a very difficult thing to do to maintain this this level of accuracy in the analog world. Fortunately, as we'll see in a moment, when we get into the digital world, it becomes an awful lot easier. Now, we can compensate inside the PC for consistent errors. So if we always have an error of X degrees or always have an amplitude error of Y dB, then we can simply fix it in software. There's two ways we can do it. We can automatically make these corrections or we can manually make the corrections. For doing manual correction, we simply have a couple of sliders. This control here, this is from PAR SDR. This slider allows you to compensate for any consistent phase error. And this slider enables you to compensate for any particular amplitude error. So you put a signal into the antenna socket. You see the image, which will be located, you can see on your band scope, which is located twice the IF away. And you manually adjust those two controls until the image disappears into the noise. With careful adjustment, you can provide 90 dB, greater than 90 dB of image rejection at a single frequency. But because of the nature of the analog components, the frequency response of the filters, the frequency response of the amplifiers we're working with, the image rejection, if you set the image rejection to be, say, 90 dB in the middle of the band. By the time you get to the edge of the band, it can have dropped significantly. It could be down as low as maybe 45 or 50 dB. So we can get around that problem by, rather than adjusting the image to be correct at one frequency, we do it multiple frequencies across a band. And this is the basis of the Rocky software. This is a couple of screenshots from Rocky, which is written, who's written by Alex V3NEA. And basically what Alex's software does, it learns how to correct the INQ using off-air signals. So rather than having to put a signal into the antenna socket, find out where its image is, and then manually null it, what Alex has done is he looks for signals on the air while your radio is switched on. Now, he looks for a strong signal well above the noise. He knows what frequency it's on, so he calculates where the image should be, goes and looks at the image, and then automatically fine-tweaks the I and the Q balance to make it the signal to be a minimum. And that's fully automatic. So the more signals you have on the band, the more points you get as nulls. So if you're on 40 meters during a contest, you can get this null pretty quickly. If you're on 10 or 6 meters today, it's going to take a long while to do, because there's just not enough signals around. And this is how the program learns. This is Alex connected to a soft rock on 40 meters a few minutes after it's been turned on. Each one of these little black dots represents a signal which the software's automatically found. It's automatically been able to null the image. So that's the IQ balance. That's the amplitude error correction. And down the bottom, sorry, that's the phase correction in degrees. That's the number of degrees that it's correcting for. And this is the amplitude variation across the band. So each one of the dots says, I found a signal, I found its image, and I've been able to automatically cancel it. This is after leaving the radio on all day. This was on 40 meters again. And as you can see, virtually every frequency, there's a little gap in the middle, which is caused by a DC offset in the sound card. You'll never get a perfect balance just there. But across the whole of the band, you've got virtually perfect amplitude and phase and amplitude cancellation completely automatically. But it does rely on the fact that there are enough off-air signals to do that. Now, this is not the full solution, since we need enough strong signals for the calibration to work. If the signals on the band are just only a few dB above the noise, we're not going to be able to find the image and cancel them significantly to make them disappear. Secondly, with an analog front end, the calibration will change with SWR, temperature, component aging, various parameters, power supply voltage alterations, etc. So you continually need to do this calibration in order for the balance to remain perfect over a large period. You also need to do it for different bands, and if you change antennas, so the SWR changes significantly, particularly with a soft rock that doesn't have a preamp to isolate the mixer components from the antenna, then you'll find the soft rock's fairly sensitive to changes of antennas and changes of SWR. So it does need, as I mentioned, it needs something for each band. If you change band and change antennas, you're going to need to recalibrate. But if you're using the same, thank you, Scotty, using the same antenna on multiple bands, not using an ATU, then the calibration holds very well for a long period. It's time consuming. It took a day to fill the entire band up just on off-air signals. Now, what you could do is you could have a signal generator, and you could plug it into the antenna socket, and you could sweep it across the band and do the calibration fairly quickly. And I believe that's what the Flex 5000 does. I believe there's a signal generator built into the Flex 5000. It does a sweep periodically to do its calibration, and the INQ values are stored in double EEPROM. So every time you turn the radio on, all the INQ values that you've previously stored are maintained. Now, I'm not trying to imply that this is not a solvable problem. There's some really smart people working on solving this. Alex has done a terrific job using absolutely no test equipment whatsoever to give you a very, very good balance. But it is a limitation of this type of technology. And as I said, there's a few ways that people are working on to do this. On the VHF bands, which are a lot wider and they're less densely populated, then it gets a bigger problem. So how do we get around this problem? We've got a lot of analog components. We've got amplifiers, we've got mixers, we've got low-pass filters. All of these are going to have variations of component tolerances. They're going to have variations with temperature, with supply voltage, etc. And each one of these variations will contribute to the error in phase between the INQ and the error in amplitude. Well, the way we do it is to get rid of all the analog components. If there's no analog components, then we haven't got them causing any INQ problems. So how do we do it fully digitally? If we want to get rid of the analog components, we still need to do that form of processing. And what techniques and technology have we got to do it? This is the ideal architecture for a fully digital approach. We haven't got there yet, and you know, we may do sometime into the future, but at the moment we can't actually implement this. But if you had a blank piece of paper and limited budget and said, I want to do this fully digitally, this is what you'd do. You take your antenna and you connect it directly to your analog to digital converter. You take the output of your analog to digital converter and put it into a digital signal processor. And you take the output from your digital signal processor, and if it's a digital mode, that's as far as you need to go. You've got it's a PSK31 or RTTY, etc. You don't need to necessarily listen to that signal. If it's a sideband or CW or other mode that you want to listen to, you put it back through a digital to analog converter. So how close to this architecture can we get today? And if we can get close to it, what are the issues of relation to performance, cost, etc., in doing this sort of technology? First thing we need to do is we need an analog to digital converter. We must sample at twice the maximum receive frequency. It's called the Nyquist criteria. And we've been sampling previously at up to 192 kilohertz. We now want to connect the antenna directly to the ADC. We can't sample 192 kilohertz anymore. We've now got to sample at RF frequencies. So if we want to go up to 6 meters, say up to 55 megs, we've got to sample at 110 megahertz. So we've gone from 192 kilohertz to 110 megahertz in our anti-D converter. This is not your average sound card. 0 to 30 megahertz, we've got to sample at greater than 60 megahertz. If we want to make a radio that's as good as the current crop of analog radios, we're going to need something like 120 dB of dynamic range. And we need to put that into our specification for our analog to digital converter. Now, we get about 6.02 dBs per bit. So to get 20 dBs of dynamic range, we're going to need an analog to digital converter which runs at 20 bits. Now, back in our sound card world, where we're digitizing at 192 kilohertz, we can get 24-bit sound card. So, you know, first sound, that looks pretty good. We can get 24 bits. Perhaps we can get 20 bits up at in the shortwave region. So what's available for our ADCs? Fortunately, the good news is chips are available that will meet exactly that specification. They've been around for many years. And I've got colleagues who work in the military and industrial areas who use chips that not only meet that spec, but exceed it. So that's very good news. The bad news is they cost about $55,000 each. So that's the first problem we got. This is a little bit expensive. So what can we do for a more modest sum, say $100? About $100, we can buy a chip called the LT2208 from Linear Technologies. It has a sample rate of up to 130 megasamples per second. That's well above what we require, so we're looking pretty good. It has an input bandwidth of 700 megahertz. That's much wider than the HF bands we want to look at, so it's looking pretty good. It has 16 bits. That's not quite our 20, so we've got a little bit of a shortfall there, but let's push on and see what happens. It's got a wideband noise floor of 78 dB, and 78 dB FS means 78 dB below full scale. So that's a long, long way short of our 120 dB, but we're not paying $55,000, we're only paying $100, so maybe we have to do some trade-offs, or maybe with some smarts we can do to go overcome these problems. So we've got a $100 ADC, we want to now do some signal processing with it. And the most likely approach is we're going to feed that data into a PC and do the signal processing inside the PC. PC is cheap, it's reasonably fast, we can program in high-level languages, and there's DSP libraries available which other people have written which we can use to do our processing. So the question we have now is we've got our AD analog to digital converter, we've got a digital data stream coming out of it, and we want to get it into our PC. What's the options for that piece of wire? So let's look how fast this data is coming in. Our chip, our LT2208, runs at 16 bits. And we want a sample at 63 megasamples per second. I'm going 0 to 30 megs, so we need to sample at least 60 megs, double that, and we'll go a little bit faster. It makes the math just easy. So we'll go at 63 megasamples per second. That works out to approximately 1,000 megabits per second, or a gigabit per second. This is pretty fast. So 16 bits, sampled at 63 meg, we do the math, that's 1,000 megabits per second, or 1 gigabits per second. Not audio frequencies. We're way, well away from our sound card. What are the options we got? We can use FireWire. FireWire is a standard Apple protocol. Many, many PCs use it. It's proven technology, works very well. Drivers available, hardware's generally available. Runs at 400 megabits per second. Not quite as fast as we need. USB 2, virtually every PC today has got USB 2 socket on it. The runs at 480 megabits per second. Again, a little on the slow side. FireWire 800, that's another version of FireWire, which runs at 800 megabits per second, so we're getting pretty close to where we need to be. USB 3, which is, I'm told, is real soon now, was due quarter two this year. I haven't heard too many announcements, but it's spec'd at 4.8 gigabits per second, so we're now seriously getting where we want to be. Ethernet, we can go between 1 and 10 gigabits per second in Ethernet, so an Ethernet solution looks very promising. And a PCIe board, PCIe connection to your PC, run up to 64 gigabits per second. So once again, another solution. So it does look we've got quite a few options of how to get our data from our A to D converter into our PC so we can start processing it. Now, I put a little note here that in practice, FireWire is faster than USB 2. So although FireWire is spec'd at 400 megabits per second and USB 2 is spec'd at 480 megabits per second, FireWire in practice runs faster because the protocol, the overheads of the protocol are much lower. There's another problem with all these figures, and that is they were written by the marketing department. So in practice, we don't quite get these figures. If we get half of them, then I think we're doing pretty well. But just gives you an idea of the options that are available to get into our PC. Let's look at our DSP requirements. So we've now got our data using one of those interface standards from our AD/DC converter, and we're now inside the PC. What can we do with it? How fast can we process this data? Well, we've got a quad-core PC, which are fairly ubiquitous nowadays. The processor speed's fine. We're running at gigahertz, so we're not going to have any problem at all about processing this data. The problem is getting data in and out of the processor's main address space across its buses, internal buses inside the PC. That's the limitation, not how fast we can process once we've got it inside the PC. The other alternative is a PlayStation 3, a very low-cost, very high-performance device. Processor speed's absolutely fine. Tons of grunt available. But we're limited to 100 base T Ethernet or USB interface. So the fact we can process really fast when we get inside the PlayStation is counterbalanced by the fact we can't get the data in there particularly fast. I'm told, based on previous experience with this sort of technology, folks are getting the ability to process between 4 to 6, perhaps 8 megs of spectrum now in real time. So you could take a 6 meg spectrum of the band, and you could process that in real time and look at and process all the signals in that 6 megs simultaneously. And that's about the limitation of today's technology. It'll improve into the future. We're going to see those figures go up. But that's practically where we are today. Now, we've got our ADC, we've got our PC. We've now got to get back to audio. And what options have we got for digital to analog conversion? That's the last block on that original wish list diagram. So for audio, we really need to output about 16 bits at 8 kilosamples per second. 8 kilosamples per second is twice 4 kilohertz, which is about the audio range we're listening to for a good quality sideband or AM signal. That's 128 kilosamples per second. And most modern sound card chips, the ones that are perhaps just built into the motherboard of your PC or a plug-in board you buy, work at 4 megabits per second. So we have no problem whatsoever of going back from the digital to the analog world. That's going to be the easy bit. So at this stage, let's take a reality check, see what we can do and what we can't do, what we can afford and what we can't afford. Well, the first problem is that our ADC does not meet our spec. It doesn't have enough bits, and it doesn't have the dynamic range we want. Also, the specification says that it was a 16-bit device. That's what the manufacturer said. But the dynamic range was specified as 78 dB. Now, there's something doesn't quite stack up here, because you calculate how many dBs dynamic range you get by taking the number of bits, raising 2 to its power, and taking 20 times the log. So 16 bits should give us 96 dB of dynamic range. But the specification says 78 dB is available. So we're actually paying for a 16-bit chip. We're actually only getting 13 of those in practice. So they're actually trying to shortchange us, even down the $100 level. It's not looking too good. Just bear with me. There's ways we can get around these problems. And in fact, these 13 bits, these three bits at the bottom end, we can actually turn to our advantage, and I'll explain how in a little while. Given the constraints of how fast we can process data inside the PC, we can get data from our A to D converter into our PC at USB 2 or firewall. That'll give us about 240 megabits per second to the PC. Matt Edius was talking yesterday about using gigabit Ethernet to get even faster speeds. So we're already making that progression into getting our data from our A to D converter into our PC at faster speeds. So with this sort of architecture, we've got enough processing power and enough bandwidth to have a 60 megahertz wide band scope. Now, by band scope, that is not a receiver. We're not processing 60 megahertz wide and be able to demodulate all the signals in 60 megahertz. What it means is we can have a band scope which has a width of 60 megahertz, not 192 kilohertz anymore, but 60 megahertz, and we can see the signals in that bandwidth, but we can't demodulate each one of them in real time simultaneously. The military can, we can't. They can afford $55,000, we got $100 in our pocket. We could also, in that bandwidth, have six simultaneous receivers, each 300 kilohertz wide. So you could have a band scope, or you have six band scopes, each looking at a different band, each looking at 300 kilohertz of width in real time. So you could be looking at 160 meters on one band scope, 6 meters on the other, looking for sporadic openings, and in the other four bands. Real time, simultaneously. The limitation is this is coming off one analog to digital converter. So you're taking the shortwave spectrum and you're picking off six receivers in that spectrum, all coming from the one antenna. So if you've got a narrow band beam, you're only going to really get a reasonable signal strength off that one and off that one antenna. If you use a broadband, let's say you use a trap vertical, then the trap vertical will give you output on all the amateur bands simultaneously. But there is a limitation with one A to D converter and your antenna system as to what those six receivers could potentially do. But nevertheless, it's a pretty useful radio. And the QSON, Phil Covington's receiver, the QSON 1R, well, I think Phil does 50 megs bandwidth at the moment, and he's got two fully independent receivers, and I think Phil's will go up to 5 megs wide, 2 5-meg-wide receivers in real time. So you can chop up that bandwidth in terms of the band display, the pan adapter display you're using, and how many receivers and how wide they are. You can, as long as you fit in the USB data bandwidth, you can ring the changes to your heart's content. So we don't meet a specification. Our ADC is not looking pretty good. The price is probably about right, but in terms of where we want to be, initial reaction is we've got a few problems. But let's push it a little bit further and see what we might be able to do. We're going to have to make some compromises, and let's see what those compromises might be. If we look how we process our signals today in the analog world, we don't have receivers that cover 0 to 30 megs. Not unless it's a very low-end cheap receiver and it shouldn't be doing that. But you know, generally, we want to listen to a single frequency within a narrow bandwidth. So we compromise already. We typically process a single frequency and up to perhaps 3 kilohertz of bandwidth for a high-quality SSB signal. So let's look at applying this technique that we're using in analog radios to our current digital radio and just see if we can use some of the compromises we have in the analog world, in the digital world, and see what effect that has. Yes, the answer is we can, and the next couple of hours I'm going to be covering exactly how we do that, what compromises we make, and exactly how it works. We use a technique called digital down conversion, DDC, and DDC is used extensively in cell phone base sites and many, many software-defined radios. Matt Attias yesterday was explaining how his hardware works, and he's using decimation in his hardware. It's a very, very common technique, well tried and tested, and many people working in that field. You can buy chips off the shelf that do decimation and digital down conversion. In the early days of Mercury, we actually did try a couple of the analog devices chips, which would implement a complete digital down conversion receiver. But it didn't quite have the performance we needed for HF. For cell phone sites where they've got a fairly limited dynamic range coming from cell phones, they're perfectly adequate. But on HF, where we want a lot of dynamic range, over 100 dB, there were too many shortcomings. So we decided to effectively build our own DDC, which is what we'll cover very shortly. So what's decimation all about? Decimation is the process of slowing down our data rate. At the moment, we have 16-bit samples, although only 13 appear to be what we're paying for, at 63 megasamples per second coming out of our A to D converter. Decimation divides this bit rate by a factor which I've called M. So we put in 63 megasamples per second, and what comes out is still 16-bit samples, but now they're going at a lower speed. They're going at 63 divided by M samples per second at a slower rate. So let's have a look at how decimation works. This is the output from our A to D converter. Each one of these little blue triangles represents a sample. They're discrete samples. The samples occur at regular time intervals. And you can very clearly see that that represents a sine wave. So these are digital values going from zero in the center to plus one and minus one. When we decimate, we throw away samples. We literally ignore them. So we're decimating this signal by a factor of three. So we keep every third sample and literally chuck the intermediate samples away. We just ignore them. So what we've got now is we can still see that we've got enough samples there so you can represent a sine wave. But our sample rate has dropped by a factor of three. So by decimating by three, what have we done? Our output data rate has now gone from 63 megasamples a second down to 21, a more manageable bit rate. But remember earlier, I said we have to sample at least twice the highest frequency we want to receive. So we're only sampling now at 21 megasamples per second. In which case, the maximum frequency we can input to our A to D converter is just fractionally less than 10.5 megahertz, less than half of that. So although we slowed our data rate down so we can process more inside our PC, we've now meant the highest frequency we can receive on this receiver, on the analog digital converter, has dropped by the same factor, 3 to 1. So how do we get around this problem? We really want this receiver to cover from 160 to 6 meters, and we really want to be able to tune over a very useful part of that spectrum. So we use superhet techniques. We fall back onto the techniques we use today in our analog radios. And this is the basic architecture of a digital down conversion receiver. This is basically how it works. This block here with mixers and a local oscillator looks very similar to what we had in the early days of the soft rock and our sound card. So we're still keeping our I and our Q signal. We still have amplification and filtering, and we go over to this is a USB bus going over to our PC. This is basically our direct conversion receiver using phasing techniques, which we've been doing in the analog world for many, many years. At the front end now, we have our bandpass filter, perhaps an attenuator to get rid of extremely large signals, our A to D converter. And our A to D converter now, the digital signal, goes straight into this block here, which is our digital down converter. The advantages of doing this conversion, this frequency conversion here in the digital world are as follows. We're simply multiplying samples by a value, by a cosine value and a sine value. We can generate this sine value and this cosine value very accurately to many decimal places. So the I and Q signals that come out of here will be perfectly matched in amplitude and have exactly 90 degrees to 0.00001 of a degree. So with this architecture, we can meet the requirements for well over 100 dB of image rejection. Because it's done digitally, we solve the problem of temperature drift, of component aging, of power supplies, of temperature, etc. So we're in the world now where we can work on our INQ signals, which we really want to do, and we've got rid of all the problems with our analog components. They don't exist anymore. Now, what I'm going to cover from now on is we're going to look in detail at each of the components in this block. This is typically implemented in a chip, and I mentioned earlier, we in the early days, we looked at using analog devices, chips, to process the to implement the digital down conversion. In Mercury and QSR1 and other receivers available at the moment, this is generally done in a field programmable gate array under software control. Just as an aside, there's a few problems with the ADC chip itself. All is not perfect in the ADC world, let alone it doesn't quite meet our spec. And that is the following. The ADC chip physically is about 9 millimeters square. That's about the size of my little fingernail. Okay. On one side of the chip is microvolt signals coming from the antenna. On the other side of the chip is the digital data signals, which is typically at 3.3 volts. So we've got microvolt signals, 3.3 volt square waves, a chip which is 9 millimeters across. Anyone want to guess what's going to happen? That's right. Doesn't matter how carefully you design this, there's going to be capacitance from one side of the chip to the other. There's going to be circuitry, there's going to be tracks, there's going to be spurious capacitance across the body of the chip and around it on the printed circuit board. So some of these massive 3.3 volt signals are going to find their way back into the input. So what do we do about that? We steal a technique from the guys who build PCs and have to meet radiation specs, and that is they use a technique called spread spectrum. They don't have their clock running at a particular single frequency, they spread their clock over a wide range of frequencies. So the amount of energy at one individual frequency is significantly less than if all the energy was at one single frequency. And this is how it works. Built inside the A to D converter, at the very output is this sequence of gates. So these are your data output lines going from D0 to D16. That's your 16 bits. And if you set a bit inside the analog to digital converter to be a high, you exclusive OR the least significant bit with all the other bits. And that, in a sense, is a very simple randomizer. It's a scrambler. So now the signals here have a random nature to them. If you put a fixed sine wave signal in here represented digitally, then these bits would always have the same pattern. But by exclusive ORing them with just the bottom bit, there's a random pattern on these bits. So if you looked at the output of this chip with a spectrum analyzer, rather than seeing discrete frequencies, you now see a noise at a very low level spread over a wide bandwidth. So let's see how this works in practice. This is one of the early prototypes of Mercury. And this is looking at the band scope in PAR SDR. And that's the wanted signal, okay? That's the signal I've put in for my signal generator. It's a reasonably strong signal. It's sort of minus 30 dBm. All these other signals around the bottom here are spurious signals which are being created at the output of the chip. If we turn the randomizer on, they all disappear. So all those spurs that would have been spurious signals on in the band, you could have actually tuned to them and they would have been annoying carriers, now disappear. In fact, they're well below the noise floor of the receiver. So there's quite a few, there's some other smarts which I'll cover in a moment built into the chip. The guys that built this linear technology 22.8 have really thought about this very carefully, and they're solving some of the problems that other manufacturers already have with their equipment by putting some smarts inside the chip. Let's look at some more of the design requirements of Mercury and exactly how the internals of the receiver work. We're going to use our LT2208 analog digital converter. We're going to sample at 122.88 megahertz. That's well above twice the top end of 6 meters, so we're meeting our Nyquist criteria. And the reason for what apparently looks like an odd frequency is this: 122.88 divides down exactly to 192, 96, and 48 kilohertz, exactly. So we're now compatible with software that runs on PCs like PowerSDR and other packages that use sound card sampling rates. We don't have to make any modifications or changes. And it also happens that manufacturers manufacture 122.88 megahertz crystals off the shelf, so we're not having to have anything made to special order. The output of our ADC will be approximately 0 to 60 megahertz, which is 0 to half the sampling frequency. So we're going to cover a very useful part of the spectrum. We're going to cover all the HF bands and well into the top end of 6 meters. We're going to decimate by 640. So we're going to keep every 640th of the 122.88 megahertz samples. And we do that, it gives 122.88 divided by 640, 192 kilosamples per second. We're now into compatibility with the SDR1000s, the soft rocks, and all the software that's available off the shelf to work with the these sort of technologies. We're going to go with 24-bit samples, which is what we're using in the Janus ADDs converter, so we can keep compatibility with our Atlas bus and the protocols we're already using between the Janus and the Aussie board and PowerSDR. So what's the data rate going over our USB bus? We've got 24-bit samples at 192 kilosamples per second, gives about 4.6 megabits per second, well inside the specification for USB 2. So we're not stressing anything or anyone in terms of the speed of data we're getting across into our PC. What we've had to contend with, though, for the time being is that we're sampling 192 kilosamples per second, just like our sound card. So our band scope is now 192 kilohertz wide. So that's the compromise we're making initially. As I mentioned earlier, we've got the capability of going up to 60 megahertz for our band scope and having a higher width of the receiver or multiple receivers, but let's just take one step at a side. The first step is let's make this as close to a sound card based system as we can so we can use all the great software that's already out there. Going back to by our decimation, we're now decimating by a large figure, 640 times, which is quite a high value. We're throwing away a lot of data. We've greatly eased the load on the PC. The data rate into the PC is about 5 megabytes per second. It's fairly slow. A general purpose PC, dual core perhaps will process that without any problem whatsoever. But we have had to add all this complexity inside our FPGA. So there is a trade-off. More complexity into the FPGA, but the gain of that is lower speed over the USB bus and the ability to process with a general purpose PC. However, there is a bit of an upside. The advantage of decimation, the advantage of throwing away samples and taking our data stream at a slower rate, is that every time we decimate by 2, we increase our output signal noise ratio by 3. Every time we halve our data rate, we gain 3 dB in signal to noise. Now, remember we go back to our original data sheet, the signal to noise ratio of our specified LT28 was 78 dB, which was long, long, long way short of the figure we needed of well over 100 dB. Let's run the numbers again using decimation from 60 megahertz down to 3 kilohertz, and that'll be our final bandwidth. So we're feeding 60 megahertz of data from the output of our analog digital converter. It goes through our decimation processes, first 192 kilohertz, then it goes into our PC software, where eventually it comes down to a 3 kilohertz bandwidth. Okay, so we've gone from 60 megahertz bandwidth down to 3 kilohertz. And the ratio of 60 megahertz to 3 kilohertz improves our signal noise ratio from 78 dB to 121 dB. We wanted 120, so we got a dB ahead. We're looking great already. So by decimating, we gain a number of things. We slow down the data speed going into the PC. We make it easier for the PC to process that data. And we gain a very substantial improvement in signal-to-noise ratio. But the trade-off is we have a narrow spectrum scope. Okay. What I might do is say we take a 10-minute break, just so I can relax my voice. You guys can have a comfort stop, and we'll carry on in about 10 minutes' time. Thank you.